gathered here together in one mind and one accord to praise the name of Jesus, the one that we adore, who's brought us out of darkness into his marvelous light. Oh, praise the name of Jesus, giver of eternal life. Come on and praise the Lord. Praise his holy name. Praise him for the good news and the joy that he brings. I want to praise the Lord while the ages roll. Glory, hallelujah, everybody praise the Lord. Let's thank him for his mercy, and let's thank him for his grace. Let's thank him for redemption. On the cross he took my place. He's coming back from glory on a cloud to call his own. Oh, praise the name of Jesus. I know it won't be long. I'm gonna praise the Lord. Praise his holy name. Praise him for the good news and the joy that he brings. Come on and praise the Lord while the ages roll. Glory, hallelujah, everybody praise the Lord. Let's all just praise the Lord. Praise his holy name. Praise him for the good news and the joy that he brings. Come on and praise the Lord while the ages roll. Glory, hallelujah, everybody praise the Lord. Praise him. Praise him. Oh, let's praise him in the morning.
Praise him.
Praise him in the noontime. Praise him. Praise him. Glory, hallelujah. Everybody praise the Lord. Come on, let's praise the Lord. Praise his holy name. Praise him for the good news and the joy that he brings. I'm gonna praise the Lord while the ages roll. Glory, hallelujah, everybody.
Let's praise the Lord tonight. How good's God been to all of us? 3 years of putting up with this, and he's seen us through it. And it's a night to praise him, I'll tell you that right now. It really is. Give me an A flat if y'all would. Sing a song with me.
Down at the cross where my Savior died, down where from cleansing from sin I cried, there to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to his name. I am so wondrously saved. Jesus completely abides within. There Jesus saved me and keeps me clean. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. Glory to his name. There to my heart was the blood applied.
Never heard that song. Where y'all been? We just did two verses of it. Stand up if you can. I want to hear some singing. This should be praise night that we've gotten to come back after all this time. And if you're not singing, I hope you're shouting. So let's sing this verse if we could.
Oh, precious fountain, so rich and sweet. Yes, I today and be made complete. Glory.
Let's sing it one more time like you mean it now. Welcome Mark Bear and the Jubilee Choir. Would you let them know you're glad to see them this year?
Me by name. I'm overwhelmed that the voice of creation speaks in my heart just the same. He tells the winds when to breathe and be still. He calms my heart when nothing else will. The God that I serve is the God of Abraham, Jacob, and Isaac, and all who
heaven. And there's been so many of us that have had loved friends or loved ones who have gone on to be with the Lord, especially over the last couple of years. So if it's okay, Brother Mark, can we just dedicate this song to all of your loved ones that have gone on to be with the Lord? Maybe you would just like to stand up on their behalf and sit back down as we honor your loved ones. How many here have had loved ones who have gone on? And you'd just like to honor them here tonight by standing up. Everyone sit, just stand up and then sit back down. We want to dedicate this in their memory. Why life always happens like it does, even though I know we're only here for a while, how come it never seems like long enough? I don't know just when my time is coming. Still, I know God has a plan for me and for you. I don't know what leaving looks like, but I know this. You won't have to wonder where I'll be. I know. the babe on their knees. They said that nothing compared to what was waiting up there, how one day we would finally be free. Well, I've never seen it, but I keep on believing it will be a place like I've never known. I keep my eyes on the sky, cause my soul wants to fly. Lord, my heart is ready to go. I wanna know how it feels to make my way down the streets of gold.
Forgotten without a trace, more than I'll ever dream. My eyes wanna see the look of love on my Savior's face.
I wanna know how it feels to make my way down the streets of gold. Singing this song, and I can't begin to tell you how much we love you all and how you're family to us, and how we love you all, and what a blessing it is to be here two nights in a row. Yay! Two nights in a row. We're going to get double blessed. So, because every time we come, we don't want to leave. That's the truth. And so, but I want you to know we've been in revivals just from everywhere over the last month. And we are ready to go. I just want you to know we are fired up and ready to go. You all are singing along with us. And this is one of our most requested songs. Sing along with us. I want to know how it feels to make my way down the streets of gold. heart's been weary, my soul's been dry, and now I'm desperate for the water. I've been so empty, just getting by, and now I'm desperate for the water. We released it on 2/22/22 on a Tuesday. And I don't think that we've ever had an album to ever come out that every song speaks our hearts. And we battled COVID writing a lot of the songs. We wrote a lot of songs through grief. And there's one particular song that is really seems to be a couple of them that are standing out above the others. And this one is one of them. You see, back last year, we were so blessed to go to Rubyville Community Church, and Brother Brian has always been so gracious, and Brother Cal, and it was Brother Cal's first Sunday morning back after, I don't think you'd preached for 52 days or something like that, hadn't preached for days, and told the story of how he would sit in the back of the church while you all would be worshiping the Lord, but he was so weak and didn't know what was wrong with him. And finally, miraculously, the Lord touched his body and he came back. So we were privileged to be there with y'all on a Sunday morning, on his first Sunday back. And he had a list about this pig, and he stepped up very slowly to the pulpit, and he began to preach about the keepers. And he started talking about the people. He said, and I'm not going to name their names, because these are the people that never want to be recognized. But these are the people that we can't do without. See, for all of the people that stand out in the cold and the rain and the heat in the summer, that are directing traffic, telling everybody where to park, you're a keeper. And for all of you that slips money into the pockets of a couple that can't make ends meet, you're a keeper. And he began to talk about every person in the church. And I'm telling you, there were a lot of people on that list. It inspired me so much that I thought about it all the way home. And on Tuesday of the following week, I was sitting in a Zoom call writing in my kitchen with two Nashville writers. And I began to share with them, y'all, let me tell you about this story about one of our favorite pastors that preached about the keepers. But we were going to write about something else. And the two writers said, the keepers? Oh, I think we've got something here. I don't think we've ever written a song about the keepers. So this here, we dedicated this song to Brother Cal. Cheers. Pulled up to a mailbox in the middle of the night. Left some money for a family who are facing hard times. He's a keeper. She's leaning on a walker, and she's leaning on her Lord. And her Sunday best, she welcomes folks walking through the door. Keep on showing love. They keep on serving others. No one sees that the Lord above. They keep on persevering. They're never letting up. Hallelujah for the faithful believers. Thank God for the keepers.
Lord, if you had been here, you could have
she said, Lord, you don't understand. He's been there 4 days. The gravestone was rolled back. Then Jesus cried, Lazarus, come forth. Then somebody said, he's alive, he's alive. say here just a minute. The Bible says the anointing breaks the yoke. And it lifts the burdens. Let's just do the ooh again.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. My, how thrilled we are to see all of you. I've sure missed you. Where you been? Been a difficult 2 years, hasn't it? But we're here and we praise God for His grace and His goodness. I sat there and thought there were three coordinators that started this together. Bob Alexander, Ed Cox, and Major Montgomery. Major went to be with the Lord. Ed went to be with the Lord since we had gathered here the last time. Bob's still here shouting it out. You know him as the Hanky Man. But we praise God for His goodness. And I thank the Lord for the singing tonight. It's great to have Karen, the group in with us. Seldom do we have a group two nights, but we felt led of God because God's doing something great right now. Time's running out. And what we do for the Lord, we need to do quickly. We don't know when the Lord's coming. I don't know the day. I don't know the hour, but I know He's coming again. And my only problem is, I'm like everyone else, I was so excited to be back that I got two sermons on my heart. And she said preach them both, but she don't know how long one of them really will be. But I do thank the Lord for His leadership. I never want to do anything without the direction and power of the Holy Ghost, because we're nothing without the help of the Holy Spirit. And we need His help and His power. But tonight I want to say something that I hope will be a blessing to you and encourage your heart. And I thank Karen for her kind words. They were there. We're like all of you. We've all got our stories to tell. I came down with what eventually they diagnosed as neurological Lyme disease. It left my hands and most of my body with the exception of my legs. They were numb. I couldn't feel anything. Went for 7 or 8 months like that. And I thank the Lord that He provided the perfect care provider for us, and went to Cleveland and got the right doctor at the right time and went through the infusions, and God stopped the spread of it immediately. And to be quite honest, I mean, it all started with Bell's palsy. They thought I had a stroke, and I didn't know whether I'd be able to preach anymore or not. I do want to warn you, the only side effect that I have is I still drool. Move the seats up a little closer, will you? But I think someone said, well, why didn't God take that away too? Just to remind me how good that He is. Because I could have kept going the way I was going. But then Candy and I both came down with COVID. She got to the place where she could only speak one or two words at a time, had been hospitalized twice on oxygen 24/7, blood clots in her lungs, still has blood clots in her lungs, but she just acts like she don't know they're there and she keeps going. But I can tell you this with a promise. I've been saying it everywhere that I go. We stared death in the eye. And death ain't no big deal. It's not that we want to go. It's just we know we're ready to go when He calls. But I do think that you need to know we have an unseen enemy. Your enemy is not people. It's not coworkers. It's not family. It's not neighbors. It's not church against church. Our enemy is not even Russia. Our enemy is not Iran. Our enemy is not any of the other nations that come against God and Christianity. Our enemy is not people that have different ideological views. That's not our enemy. Our enemy is not flesh and blood. But we have an enemy. He's real. Years ago, there was an old Bedouin that he got up early one morning, and those that worked for him came around and he said, "Keep your eyes open, stay sharp." Said, "Because we know there's an enemy that was in the camp last night." They said, "How do you know that? Did you see him?" He said, "No, I didn't see him, but I saw his tracks everywhere." And we see his tracks coming against the church, coming against everything that he can. We know that he's trying to do all that he can, but I think that you need reminded tonight of the fact that even though we have an enemy, he is the devil. The Bible calls him Satan. The Bible calls him the Antichrist. The Bible calls him as well the roaring lion. You say, "Well, I don't believe in a devil." Well, if you don't believe that it's true in the Bible about the devil, you can't believe that other things in the Bible are true. See, if the Bible's not true about hell, the Bible's not true about heaven. But I want to tell you, there is a heaven and there is a hell and there is a devil, and he hates the church and he hates you, and he's going to try to do everything he can to stop you. But I've not come to glorify the devil. I've come to tell you, glory be to God. We've got authority over the devil in Jesus' name. And he has power. He has power to help us when we face the enemy. Let me ask you this. Why is it that it seems as though Satan can defeat some people and not others? Have you ever thought about it? Why is it that he seems to be successful? I'm not saying that one person's more spiritual than another, has more biblical knowledge than somebody else, but why is it that he seems to be so successful with some, but with others, he doesn't seem to get a foothold with them? I think that you need to understand, we are saved by the blood. Faith in the blood of Jesus Christ makes us saved. But faith in the Word of God makes us safe. I venture to say probably the majority, if not all of you, when you left your home tonight, you locked your doors. Because experience has taught you there are people that will come into your property and do damage. And the Bible's the Word of God that tells us how to fight against this enemy that we have called Satan, the devil. The Bible says in 1 Peter 5, verse 8, "Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, is a roaring lion walking about, seeking whom he may devour, whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world." There's some things that we need to know about our enemy. First of all, we need to know that we need to be sober. That means that we need to be alert. We need to be aware, and we need to be calm in the Lord and in His Word and trust His Word. We need to be vigilant as well. You need to be aware that He is there and that He loves to fight. And I can tell you that He's already tried to fight this meeting, but He didn't win before and He's not going to win now. You need to understand that He is adversarial. The Bible says He is your adversary. You have an enemy, and you are his adversary. If you claim the name of Christ and trust the Lord as your Savior, you are automatically against him. Amen. Jesus said, "But you can't be for me and against me." You have chosen the side that you're on when you say, "I choose Christ." And the devil hates you just because you love him, Jesus. He is your adversary. He is active. He's going to and fro, walking to and fro. He's active. You don't have to go very far until you find that he's fighting everywhere. A fellow one time came to me for some counseling, and he just wore me out. Have you ever had somebody just wear you out? I mean, he just wore me out. He did all the talking. Never have understood. You want help, but you don't ever let anybody else talk. He did all the talking and all the answers, so it didn't matter what I had to say because I couldn't say anything anyway. But he kept going on and on about all the problems that he had. And he finally got to the place that he said, you know, the thing about it is, though, preacher, I reached a place where that I finally don't have to battle him anymore. And I said, oh. He said, did I say something wrong? I said, you absolutely did. Because if you're on God's side, you're going to battle him. You're going to fight him. But it also says that with his appetite, he would love to devour you, but it says he may devour you. It doesn't say that he will. There's a big difference between the word may and will. He'll try to, but that doesn't mean that he's successful at it. So he says if we want to understand and know about our enemy, we have to look at some of the characteristics of our enemy by the names that the Lord has given to our enemy. And here in this passage, he called him a roaring lion. Well, if we don't know much about lions, it doesn't do us much good to know about the devil if we don't understand lions. Let me just give you two or three things about lions very quickly. First of all, did you know that lions are nocturnal? They sleep in the daytime, and they do their best hunting at night. They can see in the dark. The dark is their domain. They would rather be active at night than any other time. It's not that they can't be active of the daytime, but generally they're sleeping throughout the day. And then when the nighttime comes, that's when they get busy. And that's when they get active. So if you want to overcome the devil, first of all, and have the authority that Jesus has given to you to overcome the devil, you need to stay out of his territory. Stay out of darkness. The word of God tells us that we'll be safe in the light. Where do you get that? Well, the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 8, for ye were sometimes darkness, but now are ye light in the Lord. Walk as children of the light. He said, what fellowship hath light with darkness? Do you know what he was saying? He's saying, if you stay out of the darkness, you're going to be safe. But as soon as you get into darkness, you're on the devil's territory. And do you know something? You can't evict a person from a house that they own. Help me preach, will you? I mean, if you're renting a place to somebody and they don't pay their rent, you can evict them because that's your property. When you get as a believer into things that are dark, that's a picture of the world. When you get into things of darkness, you lose your spiritual authority and your spiritual power because now you're in his domain and you're trying to cast him out of his own house. He is the God of this world. Plain and simple, if you want power over the devil, stay out of the world. So he says they're nocturnal. Then he also says, this is the only way I can describe it. Do you know lions don't see like we see? They are, the best term that I could give for it is they're paravisual. They're not only nocturnal, they're paravisual. What's that mean? Well, let me describe it. See, I'm standing on this platform. And we're looking back out over, I know there's well over 1,000 here tonight with the number of chairs that's out. Brian will let you know how many at the close of service. But as I look across this crowd, I can single you out. I can look there and say, there's Don. I can look over there and say, there's Steve. There's Ron. I can look and say, there's Jacob. I can look and say, there's Fred. I can look through this crowd, there's Bob sitting back there. A lion can't see like that. When a lion looks at a crowd, a lion doesn't see the individuals. He can only see as one. So when a lion would look at this section of people sitting here, he wouldn't see you as an individual. He would see you all as one. Have you ever wondered why those safari vehicles can pull up in the middle of lions? Yeah, I remember when I studied for this the first time, I was watching a documentary that was on television, and they were going out on this trip through Africa, and they had these people in these oversized jeeps, and they didn't have canopies over the jeeps. There wasn't a top on the jeep. There was no side on the jeeps, and the jeeps weren't that tall even, and they pulled right in among a group of lions. The lions would come up, and they would bite at the tire. or they would put their nose against the vehicle. The guide there said, whatever you do, you stay in this vehicle. Said, if you stay in this vehicle, you'll be safe. I'm about to preach. You stay in this vehicle, you'll be safe. But if you get out, that lion sees you as an individual then. And now he knows that instead of you being bigger than him, he is now bigger than you. Because when you get out, you're on your own. And he mentioned that one time they had a group there and one of the individuals didn't listen and they got afraid because the lion got close to their side and they jumped out of the Jeep and the lion mauled them to death. And he said if he had just stayed with the group, he'd have been okay. Because they see them as one. Not like others, the herd, they come, they try to always, if they see a group of animals there that they want to attack, they'll try to attack the herd and single one off, because if they get one off, they know that they're bigger than that. Some of you haven't caught on to this yet. See, by ourselves, we're no match for the devil. But you get us all together. If you're here tonight and you have any need in your life, I think you need to come forward in a few moments and let God's people gather around you and let us remind the devil, you picked on the wrong county and you're in the wrong place. It is not every church trying to row their own way down the seashore to make it to the other side. We're in this thing together. God loves us all, cares for all of us. We're saved by the blood of Christ, and without Jesus, we are nothing. But when the devil comes against one of us, he comes against all of us. Why do we see things happen at a place like Jubilee where you don't see it happen sometimes on your own? Can I tell you one reason why? There are 34 churches that are actively involved in this meeting this week. A lot of new churches that are here. Thank you. God bless you. That you said, you know, reaching souls is worth more than just saying I care about me. You say, well, preacher, you pastor a church. Yes, but you'll never hear me say that my church is more important than any other church. The truth of the matter is, we are all family. We just live in different houses. And plain and simple, we need to come together under the bloodstained banner of the Lord Jesus Christ and remind the devil we are a mighty army that has risen up to come against Satan in these days and let him know he will not win. He is not in control. He does not have authority. When Jesus conquered death, hell, and the grave, he knocked at the door of hell, took the keys of death and hell. Now the devil can't even get in and out of his own house without permission of the church. That's why you can say, Satan, you have no business here. None. They are paravisual. When we realize that we need one another, that's when we're the best. But also they are territorial. This is all about territory. That's why the devil fights you. He wants you to give up your promised land. Pastor, if he can single you out and get you to feeling like you're all alone and nobody in the church cares about you, the next thing is you'll lose fire with God and power in the pulpit. And then the whole body hurts. I'm still preaching. Not much shouting, but it's true. Do you know that's contagious? If I learned anything through all of this sickness, and I have always done my best to praise the Lord, but I ask God, I don't know what I'm going through, Lord, but I know you've got your hand on all of it, and I'm not worried about any of it. I have perfect peace. There's God's people everywhere praying for us. We weren't worried about any of that. But the only thing that I wanted to do was to make sure that I didn't lose the opportunity to praise God every chance that I could. And our church will verify it. I know we had to wear masks and all the other things. We were just like all of you. We were going through the middle of it, and there was a time that I couldn't even speak a word. I've got a friend here tonight that his dear wife passed right after that I got hit. The week I got hit with Bell's palsy, his wife passed. And he said, I want you to preach the funeral. And I'm not making fun of anybody. I'm making fun of myself. And I told him, I said, I can't even talk because they don't preach the funeral. That's the way I talked. And he said, I want you to preach it anyway. I don't know if anybody understood me or not, but the Lord understood me. And I did my best. And sometimes we'd have to come in late to go in the balcony. Sometimes I'd lean over to Candy and I'd say, stand me up. And I'd stand up there, nobody else around us, but we'd be waving our hands, thanking God for His glory and His grace. Do you know why? I don't care what you're going through. You're not going to stay in it. We're headed to a land that's fairer than day. One day God will deliver us from all of it. And until then, we're going to hold His hand and say, you picked the wrong one to come against. The Lord has always given authority over all of the beast. In Genesis 9:2, He said, and the fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth and upon every fowl of the air, upon all that moveth upon the earth and upon all the fishes of the sea. Into your hand are they delivered. I didn't write that. That's the word. Do you believe it? So what He's saying is God said, I made a way for you to be able to have power over the roaring lion. What is it? Stick together. Get together to pray. Get together to sing. Get together to worship. Get together. Why do you think that the devil was so pleased when COVID hit our land? Because he thought he'd stop God's people from getting together. But he didn't know God already had it all figured out. Had live stream put in churches. Folks, they maybe couldn't all come at the same place, the same time, but they could get on live stream and worship the Lord and praise God together. He didn't win. He didn't win then. He's not winning now. He's never going to win. Thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Well, what is our roaring lion? I believe the number one roaring lion to see His presence, the number one thing we face, since He wants to intimidate us, the number one tool that He uses is fear. Fear of the doctor's report. Fear of your position on your job. Fear of failing the test. Fear of not passing the exam. Fear. Fear that your marriage is going to fall apart. Fear that your children won't be saved. Fear that your loved ones will never be released from the bondage of addiction. Fear, 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 fear. He loves to use fear. If He gets us afraid, He knows it'll cripple us. And soon we'll do nothing. I hear people all the time say, well, I'll pray and pray and pray and pray. You don't need to pray 10 hours. You need to pray 10 seconds. The problem is not what you're praying. It's what you're believing. I mean, when you pray in His name, He's already given us the promise that He said that if we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us of our sin. He has already given the promise, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. He's given us that promise. But you're afraid to step out by faith and say He did it. You're afraid to say He is healing me when you still have the symptoms. You say, I have no fear, but I'll guarantee you, a lot of you, you know the doctor's number better than you know John 3:16. Fear. We live in fear. He controls us. I don't want to make you angry, but you need to see this. Fear is always an add-on that the enemy puts on our life. God never intended us to live in fear. I went to visit a gentleman one time. He was dying. The doctor just left the room, walked out of the room. All the doctor was doing was going by the test and what the test was showing and told him the results of the test. And he said, "You're dying." When the doctor left the room, the man seemed frustrated and aggravated, irritated. And finally, he opened up to him and he said, "Preacher," he said, "I tell you, I'm just mad." I said, "Well, what's wrong?" He said, "I hear you and all these others talk about visiting people and seeing people leave this world and they have a testimony and said you talk about the peace of God and they hear singing and they have this peace." And he said, "I'm terrified. I'm afraid." I said, "Are you really?" He said, "Yeah." And he said, "Well, what do you think's wrong? Why doesn't that work for me? See how the devil does it? It'll work for somebody else. Do you find it easier to pray for somebody else's needs than your own needs?" Of course you do. Because it's always easier to believe God for somebody else. But he said, "I'm going through this," and he said, "I'm just terrified." And he said, "I can't figure out why." So I let him go on and on. The more he talked, the more angry he got. And he finally looked at me and he said, "Why is it this way? Can you help me?" I said, "I will if you'll listen." He said, "I'll listen." I said, "It's simple." He said, "What?" I said, "You're not dying." He said, "What?" I said, "You're not dying." I said, "You're not going to get dying grace until you're dying." He said, "Well, that's not what the test showed." I said, "Do you believe what the tests say, or do you believe that God has promised to be with you in the hour of death? Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me." Did he not say, "For God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind"? Fear is a spirit that is sent by the roaring lion to try to make you think God has failed and God won't do it. And he looked at me and he said, "Do you really believe that?" I said, "I tell you how sure I am. I'll see you in the morning. I'll be back." Went back the next day, he was there. I said, "I'll see you in the morning," and I went back. The next morning he was there. I said, "I'll see you in the morning," and I went back. After about a week, they dismissed him. He's still alive, going to church today. Let me tell you something. The reason that the devil does that is he wants you to think that God's word is not sure. But listen, you have every right to come against the lion and say, "I know a greater lion. He is the lion of the tribe of Judah." Isn't it something? He said the tribe of Judah. What does Judah mean? Praise. He's the lion of the tribe of praise. He's the lion of the tribe of praise. You know, it feels pretty good. You ought to try it sometime. Just lift your hand and say, "Lord, I praise you that I'm saved and on my way to heaven. I praise you that I know that you have it all under your foot and in control. Lord, I praise you for who you are and what you've done." Praise. He's not given you the spirit of fear. So what are you worried about? What is it that's plaguing your mind? If we want to really see a genuine stir of God, I preach a lot on prophecy. And I don't preach on prophecy to scare people. I preach on prophecy to prepare people. You don't have anything to be afraid of. "Oh, but preacher, you don't know what this world's coming to. You don't know who's coming to this world. You don't have anything to worry about. He's in control. He calls the shots. All you have to do is love him and trust him and praise him. Stay in his word and talk to him and love him with all of your heart. He'll take care of everything."